Journalists, ladies and gentlemen, 27 years ago, we saw the end of the Berlin Wall. In 2004, we applauded the historic enlargement. But 1 year ago, European Convention finished its work dedicated to the future of Europe. Bienvenue, Monsieur le Président, Valéry Giscard d'Estaing, au sein du Parlement européen, où vous avez présenté le projet du traité constitutionnel élaboré par la Convention européenne. Je vous remercie d'avoir accepté mon invitation de partager vos idées sur le futur de l'Europe de nouveau avec nous. I'm equally thankful to Antonio Vitorino and Mr. Klaus Hensch, both members of the Presidium of the Convention, and Madame Danuta Hübner, member of the Convention and chairwoman of AFCO committee, to join us in the panel. I'm less happy to inform you that three other members of the Presidium, Anna Palacio, Michel Barnier, and John Bruton, had to cancel their participation in the last minute because their important duties called them to do so. But two of them were available to prepare, their thoughts in a written or audio way. Why I decided to take this initiative for this debate? Because I think that the European project is at stake. We have been facing unprecedented crises, financial one, Greece, refugees, Brexit. I will not continue that way. And it seems that the diversity, European diversity, tends to transform into dangerous divisions than to unity. And the sense for community is weakening. We are living now in a different atmosphere than in a great time of European Convention and romantic time of enlargement. And we have to find a way out with new vision for Europe and strong political commitments. Arrangements in the spirit of the business as usual are not enough. And this has been shown today in USA as well. Let me finish by pointing out one of the key words of the European Convention, the closeness to the citizens. I believe this is the way. We must listen to citizens' concerns in the way which will keep the European project alive. This debate is aimed at the exchange of views of some of those who used or are still using the chance to shape Europe which delivers. Now I'm happy to welcome with respect and gratitude a friend and colleague of us, Paolo Rangel, who, as the first man of European Ideas Network, kindly offered necessary support for this event. He is also the man responsible for the Future of Europe project in the European Ideas Network. Paolo, the floor is yours, and thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I would like naturally first to welcome President Valéry Giscard d'Estaing. Je dois dire que pour notre groupe, mais aussi pour le Parlement européen, je pense que je exprime en sentiment général, le président Giscard d'Estaing est une référence politique européenne, une des grandes références politiques européennes. Il représente vraiment non seulement une grande référence politique pour la France, mais aussi pour l'Europe. Et pour nous, il est très très important de entendre, d'écouter sa vision, sa appréciation, son bilan de la construction européenne dans un moment aussi important comme est le moment présent. Je le fais maintenant en nom du groupe du Parti populaire européen et non seulement de notre think tank European Ideas Network, parce que le président du groupe, Manfred Weber, m'a demandé de dire que le groupe apprécie beaucoup cette initiative, votre présence, et naturellement remercie notre collègue Alojz Peterle pour avoir organisé une initiative comme cette initiative ceci. And now, only to close, I would like also to say that we also welcome Danute Hübner, Klaus Antsch and Antonio Vitorino, and we thank you very much for your presence here. Unfortunately, because I'm leading with the future of Europe, I will now have a meeting with Guy Verhofstadt that is doing the report on the future of Europe with treaty change. And Elmar Brok is doing the report, Future of Europe Without Treaty Change. The content is more or less the same, I must say. But, as we have this meeting because there was no occasion, unfortunately, I won't be here to debate with you. I won't be here to debate with you. But once more I say, in the name of the EPP group and in the name of our think tank, I wish you a fruitful debate that we want to incorporate in this document that we are preparing now on the future of Europe, a document from EPP group that then will be also used in EPP party and probably will be approved in the EPP party congress in Malta on March 2017. So this is a major occasion to have some contributes, to have some, new visions, and visions from people that really are true Europeans and that are aware of all the difficulties that we have, and to incorporate these visions in this work that we are doing. So I would say once more, bienvenue, Monsieur le Président, and thank you very much, Alojz Peterle.
Paolo, thank you very much. Obrigado. And now I'm honored to pass over to our moderator, Mr. Michel Plumley, who will moderate the debate. He is known as a journalist, member and co-founder of the Club Européen de la Presse Francophone. Michel, it's your turn.
Thank you very much. Merci beaucoup. Et je vais tout de suite donner la parole à Monsieur le Président Giscard d'Estaing. Je voulais très vite rappeler que Monsieur le Président a été membre du Parlement européen de 89 à 93, que quand il était président de la République française, il a créé le Conseil européen, ça date de 74, qu'il a proposé l'élection au suffrage universel du Parlement européen 79. Avec Helmut Schmidt, ils ont été à l'origine de la création du système monétaire européen, nous sommes en 79 toujours, et qui a aussi eu la création du G8, 75, si j'ai bonne mémoire, pour la première réunion. Voilà. Alors, évidemment, nous connaissons Monsieur le Président Giscard d'Estaing comme le président qui a été choisi au Conseil européen de Laeken de décembre 2001. Et je voulais rajouter que vous avez été élu membre de l'Académie française en 2003. Vous avez la parole, Monsieur le Président, s'il vous plaît.
Alors, écoutez, merci beaucoup après cette présentation très bienveillante et très ample. Alors, je salue le président Peterle qui a pris l'initiative de cette réunion et je salue les personnalités présentes, surtout celles qui ont été dans la Convention européenne, en leur disant le grand plaisir que j'éprouve de les retrouver. En effet, il y a maintenant 13 ans que nous avons mis fin aux travaux de la Convention sur l'avenir de l'Europe. 13 ans. Ces travaux avaient abouti à un texte qui était de bonne qualité, je dois dire, qui était dû à tous les membres, et en particulier d'ailleurs au secrétariat, et notamment à notre secrétaire général, Lord Kerr, qui était britannique. Et nous avons établi un document qui pouvait être considéré comme un traité fondateur de l'Union européenne. Et je remercie celles et ceux qui ont participé à cette aventure et qui, j'espère, s'en souviennent comme moi. Alors, aujourd'hui, 16 ans après, où en est-on ? D'abord, on peut dire que l'Union européenne ne va pas très bien. Il n'y a pas lieu d'avoir un optimisme exagéré. Elle ne va pas très bien. Elle a traversé et traverse encore une crise économique et financière qui a été assez pénible pour les populations. Nous avons gardé un taux de chômage important. Vous venez de voir l'élection qui s'est passée aux États-Unis, mais le taux de chômage aux États-Unis est inférieur de 3 points au taux de chômage dans l'Union européenne, où nous avons 8,5% de chômage. Taux de chômage trop élevé. Et c'est un taux qui frappe durement les jeunes dans certains pays fragiles, comme par exemple la Grèce et même l'Espagne. Si les résultats se sont un peu améliorés, ils restent encore assez sévères. On a des rythmes de croissance relativement faibles, puisque c'est de l'ordre de 1,8% pour l'année en cours, et qu'on peut redouter un chiffre un peu inférieur pour l'année prochaine. Alors, en plus, et c'est cela que vous avez cherché à clarifier, il y a une certaine confusion sur les projets. Et l'opinion publique ne sait plus très bien quel est le projet européen, comment il se déroule et quel est son avenir possible. Alors, la première idée qui est simple, mais qu'on n'arrive pas à faire passer en réalité, c'est qu'il y a deux projets européens. Il y a un projet européen issu de la zone de libre et il y a un projet issu de la volonté d'intégration européenne, c'est la zone euro. Et les deux projets sont différents. Alors, la complication, c'est que les pays de la zone euro appartiennent à la zone de libre-échange et que, d'autre part, les pays de la zone de libre-échange n'aiment pas penser qu'ils sont écartés ou exclus de la zone euro, ce qui est malheureusement la réalité. Alors, on a une espèce de combat permanent. Les institutions européennes cherchent à étendre leurs compétences. La Commission, qui est beaucoup trop nombreuse, Commission à 28, ça n'a pas de sens. Il n'y a pas d'organisme de gestion ou que ce soit, qu'ils soient des organismes à 28 avec égalité des droits de vote. Donc la commission que nous avions proposé de former, qui dans le traité constitutionnel revenait à 13 membres, en réalité, et qui est restée à 28, malheureusement cherche à jouer un rôle un peu dans tous les domaines sans ressentir les limitations de son action. Alors, moi, je voudrais vous parler de la zone euro. Non pas de la monnaie, mais du fait que c'est la partie du projet européen qui prolonge en réalité le projet initial. Quand les deux fondateurs originaux du système européen, c'est-à-dire Robert Schuman et Jean Monnet, ont parlé dans les années 1950, ils voyaient très loin devant eux, en réalité, une structure qui n'était pas définie, mais qui était de type fédéral pour l'Europe. Il y a eu un grand débat à l'époque, le Comme vous savez, les Britanniques ont refusé d'entrer dans le système. Le général de Gaulle était hostile au fédéralisme. Et donc, il y a eu une période assez troublée dans laquelle on s'est contenté de faire avancer les échanges et d'aller jusqu'à une zone de libre-échange, ce qu'on a réussi à faire. Mais à partir du traité de Maastricht, c'est-à-dire 1992, la progression en avant du système Schuman-Jean Monnet s'est arrêtée. Et on est resté dans des débats assez compliqués de compétences entre les institutions et malheureusement de malaise de l'opinion publique. Moi, je voudrais mettre en garde, hein. S'il n'y a pas de progrès dans les prochains mois, les élections européennes peuvent être désastreuses. Il faut être conscient de cela. C'est-à-dire qu'elles peuvent montrer qu'il y a en Europe une majorité de gens qui ne croient pas, en fait, à l'utilité et au bon fonctionnement du système. Donc je crois qu'il ne faut pas rester dans cette passivité et qu'il faut être capable, au contraire, de proposer de nouveaux progrès. Comment peut-on proposer des progrès à l'heure actuelle en Europe? C'est en regardant le monde. Quand on a fait les premières avancées, on regardait l'Europe et on a voulu faire la paix en Europe. L'Europe avait été le siège des deux dernières guerres mondiales, 14-18, 39-45, guerre en partie absurde et extraordinairement meurtrière, et on voulait que ça ne puisse plus se reproduire. On a atteint ce résultat. L'Europe est actuellement une structure pacifiée. Quelques petites exceptions près, mais qui disparaîtront probablement prochainement. On pourrait dire, à ce moment-là, il n'y a qu'à s'arrêter. On a fait l'Europe pour la paix, on a la paix, c'est terminé. Non, parce que le monde a changé. Et dans le monde nouveau, nos pays d'Europe sont trop divisés, en réalité, pour pouvoir continuer à être ce qu'ils sont, c'est-à-dire les porteurs d'une civilisation historique, d'un mode de vie et d'une identité. Il faut savoir, c'est quand même relativement simple, que l'Europe est le continent le plus divisé du monde. Elle est plus divisée que les États-Unis, même que l'Amérique centrale, même que le sud-est asiatique. C'est le continent le plus divisé. Et si on veut retrouver un sens, un rôle, il faut bâtir en Europe une puissance économique de niveau mondial. Donc les porteurs du projet, ceux qui ont avancé en direction de la zone euro, proposent de continuer d'avancer et de bâtir une union économique européenne dans les 20 ans prochains qui mettra notre économie au niveau de ceux de la Chine et des États-Unis. Il faut savoir, parce qu'on est très modeste ou mal renseigné, que par exemple le PIB de l'Union européenne est pratiquement égal au PIB des États-Unis. Et qu'il est deux fois plus important que celui de la Chine. Moyennant quoi, toute la population européenne croit que nous sommes un ensemble économique relativement secondaire, relativement insignifiant. Si au contraire, on organise une puissance économique en Europe, cette puissance économique fera qu'il y aura dans le monde trois puissances économiques, les États-Unis d'Amérique, la Chine et l'Europe. j'aperçois des personnalités indiennes, naturellement, l'Inde aura aussi son rôle à jouer dans le monde. Ça ne sera pas un monopole, mais ça sera la réalité. Est-ce que l'Europe actuellement divisée, qui est incapable de régler la crise économique, qui souffre d'agitation bancaire et monétaire, y compris dans certains grands pays comme l'Allemagne et l'Italie, est-ce que l'Europe peut devenir une puissance économique mondiale? Ma réponse est oui, et considérer que cela n'est pas très difficile. Alors, il faut naturellement que les dirigeants le souhaitent et qu'ils mettent en œuvre les politiques correspondantes. Alors, qui peut faire partie de cette puissance économique européenne? Eh bien, d'abord, les pays qui ont choisi d'adopter la monnaie commune. Premier filtre. Ceux qui n'ont pas choisi, ne peuvent pas choisir la monnaie commune, ne sont pas dans ce groupe. Donc, ce groupe comprend les pays, à l'heure actuelle, qui ont choisi la monnaie commune et qui se situent, comme vous savez, au nombre d'environ une vingtaine. Quel doit être les priorités et le calendrier qui suivent? En réalité, ça consiste à réaliser par étapes ce qu'il fera une puissance économique européenne. Prochaine étape, c'est mettre en commun la fiscalité européenne. Il est absurde de penser qu'une entreprise qui travaille à Lyon en France, Milan en Italie, Munich en Bavière et Amsterdam est obligée de gérer quatre systèmes fiscaux différents. Alors qu'aux États-Unis, qui viennent de voter, les entreprises qui sont en Californie, à Londres et au Texas ont un système fiscal unique. Donc la prochaine étape, c'est la création d'une fiscalité européenne pour les États membres de la zone euro qui voudront avancer. Fiscalité qui devrait porter sur l'activité économique, c'est-à-dire les entreprises, sur les revenus et sur le patrimoine. La confection de cette fiscalité européenne ne devrait pas se faire par négociation entre les États, car elle n'aurait aucune chance d'aboutir. Il y a eu des travaux intéressants, notamment grâce à la Commission, pour certains types d'impôts, et notamment pour la taxe à la valeur ajoutée, où on s'est rapproché d'une fiscalité européenne. Il faut aller plus loin et que ce soit la même fiscalité dans tous les pays de la zone. Pour l'impôt sur le revenu et l'impôt sur le patrimoine, il faut choisir le type d'impôt qu'on veut conserver en Europe. À l'heure actuelle, nous avons une fiscalité qui vient du XIXe siècle, c'est-à-dire de la période de l'industrialisation et du développement économique. Je regarde l'heure, je sais jusqu'à combien. Il me reste combien ?
Quelques minutes, si on veut passer à quelques questions.
Encore ?
Vraiment ?
Ah bon ?
Très peu. Excusez-moi, on avait prévu de terminer à 15h30, mais je parle avant les questions.
Nous avons des fiscalités qui viennent du 19e siècle ou du début du 20e siècle et qui ont été élaborées chacune dans une culture différente. La fiscalité allemande remonte au début du 20e siècle, en fait. La fiscalité française aux alentours des années 1910-1930, et elles ont des caractères complètement différents dans leur organisation. Si on cherche à les rapprocher, ce qu'on cherche à faire parfois, on est sûr d'échouer. Donc il faut une nouvelle approche consistant à réunir, alors on peut dire qui, mais enfin je ne veux pas entrer dans trop de détails, à réunir les responsables fiscaux des États, non pas pour négocier rien, mais pour définir ce que doit être un impôt européen. par exemple, pour l'impôt sur le revenu? Est-ce que c'est un impôt proportionnel ou progressif? Quand commence-t-il? À quel niveau? Jusqu'à quel niveau doit-il s'élever et avoir son dernier taux? Et il faut une large discussion sur ce sujet et arriver à un impôt sur le revenu modèle. Après quoi, chacun des États évoluera en direction de cet impôt, puisque les départs sont différents, et en un délai qu'on fixera, qui à mon avis serait au minimum de 10 ans, au maximum de 15 ans, arriveront à cette fiscalité européenne unique. Après la fiscalité, l'étape suivante, c'est la dette. Les problèmes de dette sont causés des drames ou des difficultés sévères dans beaucoup de pays. Naturellement, tout le monde pense à la Grèce, mais pense aussi à l'Espagne, pense aussi un peu au Portugal, un peu à l'Irlande. Et quand vous regardez un tableau international, vous avez une cotation des titres de dette pour chacun des pays d'Europe. Et une cotation unique pour la dette américaine. Il y a, lorsque les Américains ont commencé à s'organiser sous l'impulsion du premier secrétaire au Trésor, qui s'appelait Hamilton, c'était la même situation. Vous aviez des États complètement ruinés parmi les nouveaux membres de la Confédération. Vous en aviez qui étaient à peu près en équilibre, et même quelquefois avec un léger surplus. Et il a mis en commun, après des ajustements importants, l'ensemble de la dette pour arriver à une dette unique faisant l'objet d'une gestion unique. Donc les gouvernements de la zone en question, j'appelle l'Europa pour simplifier, ces gouvernements doivent désigner un petit groupe de personnalités et d'experts qui existent. On en a connu quelques-uns, même qui ont travaillé avec nous pour créer l'euro, pour voir comment fusionner les dettes européennes, à quel rythme, et en prenant en compte quelle évaluation pour chacune d'elles, de façon à aboutir à une dette unique. Et ensuite, naturellement, avoir une émission unique chaque année de dette publique européenne. Deux remarques. On créera alors un trésor européen et on aura le résultat classique dans la construction des États d'avoir la monnaie avec une banque centrale et la dette avec une organisation centrale. Un trésor de la dette publique. Il faut se rendre compte que si on ne le fait pas, si on laisse le laisser-aller actuel continuer, la moitié des pays de la zone euro seront en faillite dans les 10 prochaines années. Parce qu'à l'heure actuelle, beaucoup d'entre eux atteignent un taux de dette de l'ordre de 100% du PIB, alors qu'ils se sont engagés à n'avoir que 60% du PIB dans le traité de Maastricht, comme vous savez. Ils ne l'ont pas respecté, ils sont près de 100%. Les taux d'intérêt sont actuellement très bas, mais ils sont appelés à augmenter. Ils augmenteront. Et si simplement ils doublent, ce qui est peu de choses quand on parle d'un niveau comme le niveau actuel, qui est proche de 0 et de 1%, la moitié des pays d'Europe seront en faillite budgétaire, dont d'ailleurs le nôtre. Donc, une dette commune, à partir d'un certain moment, gérée par un trésor commun, un trésor européen, dont je proposerai qu'on l'installe à Strasbourg. Pourquoi Strasbourg? C'est pour laisser à Bruxelles sa vocation principale, qui est la gestion de l'Europe à 28, et pour avoir une zone dans l'Europe spécialisée dans les affaires monétaires, qui sont Francfort pour la monnaie et Strasbourg pour la dette. Après ces réalisations, le problème sera de créer deux choses. Une solidarité financière entre les États et une bonne communication avec la population. La solidarité financière entre les États, elle est indispensable car dans tout grand État économique, il y a des régions riches et des régions pauvres. Et ceci tient à des facteurs géographiques, sociologiques ou autres, ce qui fait que si les institutions sont les mêmes, il subsiste des écarts assez grands dans la richesse locale, dans les revenus locaux. Les Allemands s'en sont rendus compte, puisqu'ils ont créé un système de solidarité entre les Länder riches et les Länder moins riches. Les États-Unis s'en sont rendus compte depuis le début, en faisant prendre en charge par le budget fédéral un certain nombre de dépenses des États pour aboutir à une certaine égalisation dans la répartition des ressources. Et donc il faudra mettre en Europe, dans cette Europe intégrée, cette Europe puissance économique, un mécanisme de solidarité transférant une partie de la richesse des riches vers une partie des besoins des plus pauvres. Il faut le faire dans des limites raisonnables, et il faut naturellement que ce soit acceptable par la population. Alors, le dernier point, c'est la population. Il ne faut pas se tromper, la population européenne n'est plus au courant de ce que fait actuellement l'Europe. Et si on la consultait, elle porterait un jugement négatif. Si rien n'est fait avant les prochaines élections européennes, c'est-à-dire les deux prochaines années, on risque d'avoir un résultat dans lequel le total des abstentions et des votes anti-européens dépasseront la majorité de 50%. C'est même, à l'heure actuelle, une probabilité. Et à ce moment-là, le côté démocratique du système s'effondre. On a commis une erreur. Et je peux en parler parce que je suis un de ceux qui ont contribué à ce qu'on la commette. Vous y avez fait allusion tout à l'heure. C'est quand on a décidé l'élection du Parlement européen au suffrage universel, décision qui a été prise en 1976-1977, finalement, on a eu tort de couper le Parlement européen des parlements nationaux. Jusque-là, comme vous le savez, les parlements européens étaient composés de délégations des parlements nationaux. Alors on observait à juste titre que la pensée européenne, que les projets européens étaient insuffisamment présentés ou représentés et que ça serait mieux dans une assemblée purement européenne. L'Assemblée européenne a été élue, réélue. Elle a honnêtement bien travaillé, il faut le dire, son travail de législatif, d'examen des textes a été mené sérieusement et honnêtement, mais le navire du Parlement européen s'est éloigné des côtes et maintenant plus personne ne connaît l'équipage. Dans nos pays, il y a des exceptions ici ou là. La notoriété des parlementaires européens est actuellement très réduite et ils ne peuvent pas imposer ou faire imposer l'approbation de mesures européennes sur le plan local. Donc il faut revenir, à mon avis, en arrière et avoir un système dans lequel le Parlement européen futur sera composé à la fois de parlementaires nationaux à hauteur, par exemple, des deux tiers, et de parlementaires élus par un mécanisme européen à hauteur d'un tiers. Il y en a fait une chose très curieuse, c'est que les vies politiques de nos États, actuellement, sont complètement distinctes. Aucun homme politique français ne s'occupe réellement de ce qui se passe en Italie, ne s'occupe de ce qui se passe en Espagne, ne s'occupe de ce qui se passe au Portugal. Aucun homme politique scandinave n'a une idée très précise de ce qui se passe dans les États d'Europe centrale. Il n'y a pas de classe de politique en Europe. Pourquoi ? C'est qu'il n'y a pas d'institution dans laquelle les élus et les responsables nationaux travaillent avec les responsables européens. Donc il faut créer cette institution, et on peut, c'est un modèle évidemment qui prête à certaines critiques, mais on peut s'inspirer du modèle chinois, qui est le congrès du peuple, c'est-à-dire une réunion annuelle publique, bien entendu, ouverte à toutes les moyens de communication, où les deux autorités, c'est-à-dire le président du Conseil européen et le président de la Commission, viennent faire un rapport sur leur action au cours de l'année passée et leur action dans l'année à venir, et où ensuite il y a un débat où peuvent s'exprimer à la fois des députés nationaux et des députés européens. Donc voilà le schéma, si vous voulez, de ce que pourrait être une nouvelle étape de la construction européenne. La construction européenne avançait tout droit jusqu'en 1992. Elle avait des étapes franchies, grâce d'ailleurs à des personnalités très remarquables. Je salue en particulier Jacques Delors, qui était un excellent président de commission à l'époque. Et puis les événements mondiaux qui se sont produits en 91-92, dont certains aspects sont très bénéfiques, comme la réunification de l'Allemagne et comme la chute du rideau de fer, ont créé une situation à laquelle l'Europe n'a pas cherché à s'adapter. Elle s'est ouverte sans se réformer. Et à partir de ce moment-là, le système rencontrait des difficultés de fonctionnement croissante qui ont abouti d'une part à la sortie de la Grande-Bretagne, au Brexit, et d'autre part au malaise relatif qui entoure actuellement les institutions européennes. Alors, ma proposition est la suivante. Un, il faut faire attention, parce que nous vivons une époque de grandes surprises. Vous avez eu cette année la surprise du Brexit, la sortie de la Grande-Bretagne, qui n'est pas encore accomplie, mais enfin qui est annoncée et décidée. Vous venez d'avoir la surprise américaine, c'est-à-dire la vote, l'élection d'un président américain non prévue du tout par le système politique et de communication mondial. Vous aurez une troisième surprise en Europe. Et donc, les dirigeants européens doivent actuellement, comme le propose M. Peterle, réfléchir à ce qu'on doit faire, puisqu'il n'y a plus la Constitution européenne, mais qu'on s'est avancé, engagé dans une voie et tracé le chemin à parcourir pour que dans 20 ans, 30 ans, l'Europe soit une des trois puissances économique mondiale. Je vous remercie.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Merci. C'était très clair.
Un très grand merci, Monsieur le Président. Alors, avant d'inviter nos trois intervenants suivants à se joindre à la table ronde, on peut prendre une question, s'il y a une question en français ou en anglais. Nous sommes ouverts en réaction aux déclarations de M. Valéry Giscard d'Estaing. Y a-t-il une question éventuelle? Sinon, j'invite nos intervenants à nous joindre à la tribune, s'il vous plaît. Je voudrais rappeler qu'on a l'interprétation anglais-français. Donc, nous pouvons discuter et échanger les vues both in French and in English. Peterle, okay. Bien, alors, pour la bonne marche de notre débat, je vais présenter brièvement nos trois intervenants successifs, et puis nous aurons trois prises de position, et nous passons à ce moment-là au débat, à l'échange de vues entre nos différents intervenants à la table ronde, mais aussi, bien évidemment, et nous espérons ardemment que la salle réagira, aura soit des commentaires, soit des questions, et je vais modérer en français and in English. Mr. Hensch, you were president of the European Parliament between 1994 and 1997. You were a member of the European Parliament, firstly elected in 1979 until 2009, so you were for 30 years. You were a member of the Presidium of the European Convention, and we know, representing the European Parliament, and representative of the European Parliament in the IGC, the Intergovernmental Conference, drafting the Constitutional Treaty. You were deeply engaged in the foreign affairs and in the enlargement process and in the institutional development of the European Union as well. Antonio Vitorino, Signor Vitorino, vous étiez député européen de 1994 à 1995 exactement, ou, si nous avons bonne mémoire, vous étiez président de la Commission des affaires constitutionnelles.
Liberté publique,
oui, je vais trop vite. Vous avez aussi été ministre de la Défense du gouvernement portugais 1995-1997, et vous avez été commissaire européen, donc membre de la Commission européenne pour la justice et home affairs, ce qu'on appelait à l'époque le JAI. Vous avez été, à ce titre, au nom de la Commission européenne, avec votre collègue Michel Barnier, membre du Présidium de la Convention européenne. Et puis, plus récemment encore, vous étiez le président de la Fondation Delors à Paris. Et vous êtes juriste et constitutionnaliste. Professor Danuta Hübner. Well, first and before anything, you're chair of the Committee of the Constitutional Affairs in European Parliament in the current legislature, and as such responsible for the different reports and being drafted in your committee in name of the European Parliament. You were the Poland first European Commissioner in 2004, in charge with the portfolio of regional policy, and you're a member of the European Parliament since 2009, chair of the Committee on Regional Development. Before enlargement, you were Minister of European Affairs of the Polish government, and you played, as everybody knows, a key role in the negotiations for enlargement. And as such, you were representative of your government and member of the European Convention as well, and you're professor of economics. Klaus Hensch, s'il te plaît, please.
Thank you.
The floor is yours.
Thank you, Michel. Ladies and gentlemen, dear ex-colleagues, l'Europe est en crise. J'aime beaucoup toujours de lire les avertissements dans mon chambre d'hôtel. Premier point, do not panic. That's also the fact with Europe en crise. The Union's founding promise has been Europe free from war. The promise has not been Europe free from crises. Crises are not a threat to the Union. Crisis solutions are just its vocation. For that, the Union's institutions, as well as Member States' governments, have shown the last 10 years a considerable and unexpected resilience in the last 10 years. Let me give you three examples for that. Not three, some examples. Take the euro. According to Financial Science and Wall Street prophecies in July 2012, the euro had still 3 to 6 months for life. In November 2016, the euro still exists, and so does the monetary union and Greece included. Member states ran risks and assisted debtors' countries to an extent never imagined when the common currency was created. The crisis is still moldering, no doubt about that. Unemployment of young people in some member states are on an intolerable high degree. But European solidarity, which is an amalgam of common interests, commitment and cohesion, proved to be far stronger than ever expected. Another example, take the refugee crisis. It revealed that the Union's omission to cover Schengen by effective and truly European external border control, and the Union omitted to take into account Member States' differently troubled national identities. It's not an economic, not a financial crisis, but it is an identity crisis. Under intense pressure, Member States found a common first answer, not a solution to be sure, to what will become the demographic challenge of the whole century. Instead of redistributing refugees along quotas, Member States accepted to reduce the number by fences, hotspots, enhanced outside border controls, by a disputable agreement with Turkey, and for a policy in North and Central Africa aligned with the Union's strategic priorities in security and demography. Or take Russia and Ukraine. The annexation of the Crimea and the military intervention in the East Ukrainian conflict revealed the Union's naivety to believe that its own neighborhood policy would not be considered as geopolitics. It's astonishing that we talk about geopolitics is new, not realizing that our own enlargement policy or our own association policy is also to a certain extent geopolitics. The Member States rejected to react to the Crimean annexation by business as usual, preferred by some Member States, and Member States rejected also as well as delivering arms to Ukraine, preferred by some other Member States. The Union chose sanctions and continuing talks with Russia and proved coherence and character. And by this surprised Moscow as well as Washington and promoted Minsk. For Europe, a split up would have been a collateral damage of Russian aggression and for Mr. Putin a sort of collateral profit. All those crises are still moldering, but in all crises the Union has shown to be flexible enough to be a learning system. I cannot see another union or even no union would have done better, except the United Kingdom. The European Union of 27 is not out of age. In the middle of the 20th century, uniting Europe focused on preventing European people from further self-destruction. In the 21st century, uniting Europe has to be focused on the self-assessment of European people in the world. External and internal security of the Union, as well as the promotion of member states' worldwide competitivity, must prevail in future. 20 years ago, the Union was surrounded by a ring of friends. Today it is surrounded by a ring of fire. Europeans must be better equipped to take over greater responsibility for their own security, being able to deter, respond to, and protect themselves against external and internal threats. USA, Europe's indispensable ally, will undoubtedly be focused mainly on Europe any longer. The Union can be distinct, but must not be detached. Russia is no longer an ideological adversary, but a powerful, perennial, irreplaceable authoritarian neighbor, and through its policy of geopolitical restoration, a rival. China is and will become more and more relevant for Europe, not alone as an economic competitor, but also as a political and military power. We are building an Asian-Pacific area that the world leads, said President Xi Jinping on the EPEC summit in 2013. That should be heard by all of those in the United Kingdom, in France or Germany, who think that their own countries are on the level to talk without the Union with China. We have to bring our ambitions aligned with our capacities and capabilities, and our capacity aligned with our ambitions. What does it mean? First, a Union that is not a state and lacks strong political and military leadership will be unable to become world-powered, acting on an eye-to-eye level with powerful states like USA, China and Russia on the global theater, and also not in the Middle East and not in Africa. As there is no relevant political will in the member states to remedy that lack of performance, the Union will remain a soft power condemned to second-order policy. Second, the global strategy paper, timidly but rightly, requires a new understanding of the Union's structure and capabilities. That means only the Union plus member states will have a strategical clout. Only through the Union will member states matter in the world. It would be a tremendous progress if that would be understood by all member states, Germany and France included. Third, EU neighbourhood policy can no longer mean association with enlargement in the cash. The composition of the Union has become existential for its future stability. Let us be clear about this. The larger Union is, the more it is far off people. Let us be clear about this. Enlargement to Turkey, and of course also to Ukraine, Georgia, Moldavia, and others, would be geostrategic megalomania, confusing size with significance. Fourth, the Brexit produced up to now no crisis for the Union. Up to now, there are no signs of further or other leavings. We have to negotiate the necessary divorce settlement, and we should do it neither with rancor nor with rebate. However, if negotiations turn from separation to remain, withdrawal populism will be fueled in some member states. And the Union must not be absorbed by the British problem for the next 10 years. If that is the case, it will lose the rest of its authority and its clout in the world. Sixth, by looking after the chimera of core Europe, the Union will lose itself, with the only result that Europe will become a playing field to other powers. An institutional core Europe composed by some member states would split up the Union. Use the existing treaty that provides for a lot of different cores of various member states acting together on certain policy fields like common currency, defense, energy, taxes, and so on. The appropriate solution that has not yet been fully used by member states. The Union is certainly unfinished, but it is not doomed to inefficiency. Seventh, democracy. That's a special challenge for the Union and for a Union that is no state. Since the first direct election of our Parliament, we succeeded to build a considerable extent what is the first and unique trans-state democracy in the world. We should be proud of that and stop the foolish babble on the Union's democratic deficit. We should not try to copy nation-states' democracies, parliamentarism, governments, electoral system, and so on the Union's level. And I am quite sure that new institutions would create not more democracy, but more confusion. The Union has to have its own system of democratic legitimation and checks and balances. It is not made to replace national democracies, but is complementary to them, under the condition that they do not show to be depraved to vitocracy. Ladies and gentlemen, for national democracy's sake, people and also governments fear to transfer sovereignty rights to the Union, but to easily accept losing them or those rights to those slot noses in the international bank systems playing monopoly with the fate of whole states and peoples, and to globally acting data combines that invisibly control and direct people's democratic will. This, not Brussels, is a real threat to democracy in Europe. My last point is nationalism back. It has never been absent. We often forget that the European Union does not stem from another planet. It was created by our deep and rooted nation states, and it is by them that the political fabric of the Union has been shaped to what it is actually, to the good and to the worse. It's by action on policies, not by constructing new institutions, that the Union will regain support. People are fed up with debates about new constructions and institutions. No new institution or competence would revive the anemic economic growth in some member states. Would reduce the scandal of unemployment in southern member states, would remediate the migration drama on the Mediterranean Sea, would create common economic, financial and social policies and spread European-wide social justice, would improve the European competitiveness in the world markets, would surmount mental reservations and national jealousy in security matters. Of course, member states could and should envisage some minor treaty changes, a repair of the treaties, if you mind. But there is neither a consensus on empowering the Union substantially nor on reducing the Union to a pure and simple internal marketplace. By the way, I do not believe that any of those reforms will increase the Union's attraction to the people. Public debate in Member States is turning from left-wing to right-wing Europe, from a political union to a simple marketplace, from integration to cooperation, from community and common institutions to intergovernmentalism. A new treaty that is not accompanied by a clear and charismatic political project will fail. Public debate on the EU the last 10 years has not been so much on the traditional split between Brussels and the people, but much more on the divide between peoples within the European Union. Just an important challenge, I think, for the champions of European construction. In the foreseeable, and I underline, in the foreseeable future, a substantial treaty reform would open Pandora's box. In history, there are times to push for progress and new constructions. And in history, there are times to hold on and to resist against spreading havoc far and wide and against decay and decline. That is why our ambition for the time being should be constancy and character. The Union is far from being doomed to failure. The centrifugal powers of crisis are not strong enough to tear the Union to pieces. The time for a new convention will come, not as a precondition for crisis solutions, but as a result of them. The occasion would be to draft a constitution that provides the Union with a stable and clear framework of fundamental values, principles, institutions and procedures, and that is leaving the functioning of the Union and the definition of the decisions on common policies to the democratic disposition of the political majorities in the Union's institutions and member states. The vocation would not be to establish a federal state, but the true union of peoples and states. Let us be vigilant when the winds of change again are pushing open the windows for opportunities. And let us be prepared to seize the right moment. Cassandras may whisper of dusk and doom. Leaders look into the shadows for a glance of hope. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hensch. Now, we know that former Prime Minister John Britton couldn't be with us today, but he was keen to send a short video clip, so let's listen to him by picture right now.
I'm really sorry that I'm going to miss the colloquium organised by my friend Loisy Peterle on the really important topic of what sort of European Union we're going to have in 2030. I think the first thing to say about 2030 is that the United States will probably be less involved in Europe than it is today, because it is becoming increasingly more self-sufficient and indeed more inward-looking. And this means that we in Europe are going to have to look out for ourselves a lot more in every field, from security to economics. Now, we need to do that together as a European Union. And to have the sort of sense of common purpose in the European Union to be able to do that, we need to do two things. I think we need to democratize the European Union even more than it is democratic at the moment. And secondly, we need to think more deeply about what are the factors that can make the European economy grow more quickly, given that it is also aging quite rapidly. On the democratization issue, to create a common European identity, I think we need to have more common European elections rather than simply national elections to European jobs. For example, the President of the European Union, whether President of the Commission or President of the Council, should be elected, in my view, directly by the people of Europe, on the same day as the European Parliament elections, but separate from the election of the Parliament. Secondly, the European Parliament elections themselves shouldn't simply be in national constituencies where national politicians are chosen for a European job. There should be a common European constituency for some of the seats where people would have an opportunity to vote on European issues alone rather than simply register a protest or an approval about national politics. As far as economic growth is concerned, here I think we need to give a great deal of thought, first of all, to the limits that there are on trying to manage the economy simply on the basis of a book of rules about debts and deficits and surpluses. Rules will get you only so far. There has to be some room for discretion, but there have to be people who have a legitimate mandate for exercising that discretion on a European basis rather than having a battle of national wills about the implementation of economic policy. And secondly, we need to give much more thought together as Europeans about the implications for economic growth of the rapid aging of our societies, where an increasing proportion of people are going to be retired and a reducing proportion of people are going to be able to be in the workforce. How can we have more rapid economic growth in those circumstances? There are, I believe, technological solutions to that. I think we need to invest very much in technologies that will release the potential of the sort of European population that we know we're going to have 10 and 15 years from now in light of the demography of our continent.
Mr. Vitorino, please, the floor is yours and with your personal approach to the ideas.
Merci, Michel. Yeah, yeah. Tout d'abord, je voudrais remercier Alojz Peterle pour nous avoir invités, dire quel est le privilège et l'honneur de rencontrer des amis, le président Giscard d'Estaing, les membres du Présidium de la Convention et des membres de la Convention ici à Bruxelles. Si vous me permettez, les quelques notes que j'ai préparées, je les ai faites en anglais et donc je vais passer à la langue franque européenne pour le moment, je crois. I will say that the challenge to identify what are our common priorities is a prerequisite, which is not a priority. It's a precondition of the success of the European project. I believe that the first priority should be to restore mutual trust among member states. One has to recognize that the euro crisis, the refugee crisis, and also Brexit has created some cleavages among the member states. And to a certain extent, if these cleavages are not tackled appropriately, they can become real permanent fractures among the EU member states. And there is no progress, no common purpose for the European project if there is not mutual trust among the member states. I guess that we will have to wait for the decisions that are going to be taken in the next year in Europe. I'm speaking about the Dutch elections, the French elections, and the German elections
next year before we can assess if it is possible to recreate that sense of mutual trust and common purpose for the European project. On the basis of such political will, it will be possible to identify what are the priorities that will prepare us for the future. Bearing in mind that definitely in a few years' time, some people say 10 years, there will be no single EU member state alone to be integrated in the G7 group. All EU economies will be after the economy number 9, which will be the German one, Klaus, so you can be reassured. But nevertheless, all EU member states alone on their own will not be present in the around the table where key decisions about the world future economy is taken. Having said that, I think that from this perspective, Brexit is a serious blow. We should not underestimate the economic impact, and of course, I believe that Brexit will really happen. The debate in public here in Brussels and also in most of the capitals is focused on economic impacts. But to be honest, in my view, the most serious blow of British departure is a geopolitical one. Two of the EU member states, for their history, for their tradition, for their culture, for their diplomacy, have a consolidated worldwide view. And those two member states are France and the UK. I think that Germany now is on the move in the transition from a geo-economic power to start becoming a geopolitical power, but in fact losing Britain as a member state means less leverage of the European Union in the world scenario, with the consequences, especially in the security and defense fields. One should not lose from sight that the departure of Britain cannot be only assumed as a trade-off between access to the internal market and free movement of people. That's only part of the story. There is a key part of the story that should not be left behind, which is the arrangements that are badly needed between the European Union and the UK when it comes to the fight against terrorism, in the cooperation, police and judiciary cooperation, including intelligence services, and in the area of security and defence. Because, of course, NATO will go on being the cornerstone of our common defence, but since last night, we need to be prepared for some surprises, even concerning NATO, coming from the other side of the Atlantic. My second priority would be to have a strategy that departs from the perspective that there will be no treaty changes, at least no major treaty changes, in the short run. We need to explore as much as possible the Lisbon Treaty, which, by the way, is to a large extent a copy-paste of the late constitutional treaty. But I know that here in Brussels it's not politically correct to say so, but I would nevertheless like to recall that the Lisbon Treaty was less intelligible, less readable, less clear than the constitutional treaty, but the content of the Lisbon Treaty is to a large extent taken on board from the constitutional treaty. But having said this, there will be no changes in the treaties because there is no political mood to adopt major treaty changes. One has to recognize that in some of the priorities, such as, for instance, the architecture of the economic and monetary union, and the banking union most in particular, some powers need to be given to the center. Some powers need to be given to the European institutions. So we need to explore as much as we can the existing treaties. And I think that with some creativity and imagination, it is still possible to work on the basis of the current treaties. And when the current treaties are not a legal basis enough to do what has to be done, I do believe that there is a price to pay that I would be willing to pay, which is to have some intergovernmental treaties that use the common institutions for the purpose of the common objective. So I'm not obsessed with the endless discussion between community method and intergovernmental method. I think that both could be and should be combined in order to enhance the effectiveness of the economic and monetary union. The key issue when it comes to economic and monetary union does not lie in the sharing of powers, because I think that to a large extent the future of the Eurozone depends on finding the right balance, to strike the right balance between sharing of sovereignty, common rules, and sharing of risk, common solidarity. And the President Giscard d'Estaing gave us today one very clear picture of what are the basic trends of common solidarity. Having said that, I think that some of the changes that are badly needed for the economic and monetary union should be defined around what kind of common instruments of solidarity should be implemented in order to guarantee that even if the Eurozone is not an optimal common monetary zone, it can be at least a functional monetary zone. It can work. We are living on borrowed times, thanks to the work of the European Central Bank, but there is a need from the political side to have more daring changes in the functioning of the economic and monetary union. The fourth priority will be definitely to tackle migration and refugee crisis. I will not elaborate on the details. Klaus has already mentioned that I think that the first prerequisite was to have control on our external borders. The situation is still very disturbing in central Mediterranean, where definitely the situation in Libya is out of control, and even some of the signs from Egypt are highly disturbing. I have serious doubts about the possibility of having a fully comprehensive common migration and asylum policy, but I think that at least a group of member states should be capable to go ahead with a common comprehensive approach to refugee and migration policy and establish at the Union at large, at the Union at 28 or probably 27, some kind of compensating financial mechanisms of solidarity for those who cannot share the, let's call, physical burden of refugees and asylum seekers coming to our member states. My last remark, and I want to stick to the 10 minutes that were given to me. I believe I still have 2 minutes. My last remark about the priorities is to address an issue that has been addressed in different terms by President Giscard d'Estaing and by Klaus Ensch, which is the relationship between the European Parliament and the national parliaments. It has always been a difficult relationship, a relationship of mutual suspicion. Maybe one of the problems we had in our track record during all these years after the election by universal suffrage of the European Parliament is that we have created the idea that the powers that were given to the European Parliament were at the expense of national parliaments. Therefore, there was a winner side and a loser side. The point today is how can we find a way where the parliamentarian accountability at national layer is mutually reinforced by the parliamentary accountability at the European layer and vice versa. It's not a negative-sum game. It cannot be a zero-sum game. But it is a game where both parliamentarian institutions, the national ones and the European one, are confronted with the same kind of deep-rooted problems in our societies. We thought, to be honest, that economic integration would inevitably lead to a quantum leap in political integration. That was the idea of the founding fathers after the defeat of the defense common community. President Giscard recalled us that the goal opposed the common European defense community in the 50s, and then the detour was economic integration. And economic integration was supposed to lead us to a moment where political integration would be unavoidable. What we have seen in Brexit and what we are seeing in our own national democracies is that identitarian questions dealing with the changing composition of the societies are making those elements of political life much more relevant than the economic ones. We could rationally say that the British have voted against their own economic interests in deciding to depart from the Union. But the truth is that all the economic arguments that were put on the table to prevent Britain from leaving were overcome, were suppressed by a key identitarian question about taking back control on our country, which is a pure political question. So we need to address the rise of populism, of xenophobic and racist behaviors in our countries, in our societies. And Europe comes up as an easy scapegoat for the radical speeches of those politicians and those political movements. And let's be clear, the targets of those movements are equally national parliaments, national democracies, and European parliaments. And we need to find a way of a coalition, a strong coalition, in defense of democracy and fundamental rights and our common values between the European Parliament and the national parliaments. That goes far beyond any kind of institutional arrangement that ad hoc can be found. That is a pure political question for the survival not only of the European project, but also of our national democracies. Thank you.
Muito obrigado, Senhor Ministro. Merci beaucoup. Alors, je voulais demander, and I would like to ask to Mrs. Hübner, if she would allow us. Yes, because unfortunately, Mr. President Giscard d'Estaing has an important meeting in Paris at the beginning of the evening, and he has to leave us. So if ever there would be a question to President Giscard d'Estaing right now, it's the moment and the correct moment. So please, anybody would like to raise a point, including to what President Giscard d'Estaing was delivering minutes ago. Please. Anybody? Griselda Pastor, please.
Merci, c'est Griselda Pastor. Je travaille pour la radio espagnole, qui est la cadena SER. J'aimerais aujourd'hui, Monsieur Giscard d'Estaing, spécialement connaître votre sentiment après les résultats des élections aux États-Unis, vous qui avez présidé, disons, une convention à l'américaine, dans un sens ou dans un autre, pour l'Europe, et qui, je crois, vous croyez profondément aux États-Unis de l'Europe. Quel est un peu votre aperçu? Est-ce que vous craignez les répercussions pour tous de cet résultat aux États-Unis?
Est-ce que vous craignez des répercussions pour tous au niveau des résultats des élections aux États-Unis? Est-ce que vous craignez une conséquence, un résultat pour tous au niveau mondial et au niveau européen des résultats des élections aux États-Unis?
Bon, ma réponse est négative. Les États-Unis ont voté après une campagne assez singulière, en fait, et ils ont fait un choix qui nous surprend. Mais ce n'est pas un choix qui nous concerne, en fait, directement. Sur les sujets qui nous concernent, il est assez opposé, semble-t-il, à la négociation de grands traités commerciaux, mais l'Europe elle-même est assez réservée sur ce sujet, en réalité, et de toute façon, ça supposerait une réflexion beaucoup plus approfondie. Il est pour la modération de la compétition entre les États-Unis et la Russie, et nous sommes, nous aussi, pour la modération de cette compétition, car l'Europe veut être le continent de la paix, de la puissance et de la culture, et ne veut pas se laisser entraîner trop facilement dans des rivalités de puissance. Sur la pensée économique, elle n'est pas très claire. Je crois qu'il souhaite alléger quelques impôts aux États-Unis. Bon, c'est leur affaire, ce n'est pas la nôtre. Donc je dirais qu'il n'y a pas de conséquences très directes, en fait, pour le reste du monde. sauf que c'est une des États-Unis qui se retire un peu des activités de la communauté internationale et qui regarde davantage les problèmes intérieurs du pays. C'est leur choix, c'est à eux de le gérer. En ce qui concerne l'Europe, de toute façon, l'Europe doit s'habituer à vivre elle-même. Il n'est pas bon pour elle d'être trop suiveuse de la politique des autres. Elle a eu cette tendance dans les dernières années de suivre automatiquement des initiatives ou des positions qui étaient élaborées à l'extérieur. Et le fait qu'il y ait un peu plus de distance me paraît personnellement une bonne chose.
Merci beaucoup, Monsieur le Président. Voilà. Et puis...
J'ajoute un dernier mot. Dans la langue internationale, au revoir, parce que je vais aller prendre un train, que les trains respectent les horaires et que donc les voyageurs doivent respecter les trains.
Bon voyage.
Au revoir.
Merci beaucoup.
Auf Wiedersehen. Au revoir.
Okay, just eventually waiting a few seconds that Mr. Peterle is back. I wanted to say that at the end, Mrs. Hübner has a specific privilege that she could listen to all comments and delivering from the different speakers. So being in the very... let's say, warm core of the daily work, not probably working 24 hours, but almost, as a chair of the Constitutional Affairs Committee. And I can see a close collaborator being involved in the same work, by the way, Mr. José. I can say that, Mrs. Hübner, it would be nice to have a kind of a view that you could not only have your position, but eventually already a few tips of reaction to what you could listen to by Presidency Skardestin, Mr. Klaus Hensch, and Mr. Antonio Vitorinen. And then I would really like the audience to react and to interact. It would be interesting to have your reactions and your reflections, and of course among the different speakers, for sure. So, please, the floor is yours.
Not waste the time. I wanted to start by saying that I was an ordinary member of the European Convention of 2002, but there was something exceptional about me, because you might not remember that the member states that joined in 2004 and were invited to participate in the convention. So we were there before joining the Union. We were already part of European Convention, and we could discuss the future of Europe and to shape not only the constitutional treaty, but through the constitutional treaty also the Lisbon Treaty, because I fully share the politically incorrect view of Antonio Vitorino about the link between the European Constitution and the Treaty of Lisbon. And I also think that I disagree with those who believe that Europe is still in crisis. I think for years we have been talking about Europe in crisis or Europe en crise, it's true, but I don't think that the European House is on fire anymore. There is a long, long list of issues that we have to address, a long list of unfinished businesses, a long list of problems that have to be addressed, which are extremely important, extremely difficult, and they all have been mentioned, and they are mentioned daily, I think, by all of us. We know them by heart. But we have also to recognize the fact that the last years were the years of, I would say, unprecedented mobilization for reforms. And if you look at what happened with Eurozone, if you look at what we did with the financial sector, and also if you look at the move within the single market, I think there was a huge progress at the same time when we were suffering from also unprecedented hits of different crises. And I think that we have now also, we have launched, we have opened several paths towards the future. We have this Bratislava roadmap. I'm quite unhappy with this roadmap, but that's another story. There is a roadmap. There are things put on this roadmap. And we hope that subsequent summits or heads of state and governments meeting will bring solutions also, will bring decisions to those problems. We are waiting impatiently for the white paper of the Commission, which we understand will go much broader. It will not be about the Eurozone only, but it will also address the future challenges and hopefully also solutions to many European problems. And we have also the perspective of the Rome event, the 60th anniversary of the Treaty of Rome, and on the 25th of March, where I, if I understand correctly, what the European Council is thinking of is that there will be really the discussion on the future. There will be, I think, many events and ideas during the Rome meeting that will take us towards the future. So maybe there is a chance that we might have a little bit of vision. I will comment on the importance of vision later on, because here we also probably disagree. Having said that, I would like to say that it's all extremely difficult, and I agree with Antonio and with Klaus that and also with Giscard d'Estaing, with President Giscard d'Estaing, that it's not going to be easy. We have to do, we know more or less what we must do, but it's not going to be easy. And the important thing is to understand why it is not going to be easy, why it is not easy to introduce the solutions, European solutions, to most of the issues which are bothering Europe. And Antonio called it lack of trust, of mutual trust. I call it just lack of political unity or lack of political cohesion. I think this is the major sickness of Europe today. If you look at cohesion at political level, we just don't have it. This intergovernmental approach, which is absolutely clear through the crisis management, but now also member states are trying to use the intergovernmental approach to the normal strategic future-oriented work, not only to the crisis management. I think that this is something which is extremely dangerous, because we clearly see that soft coordination does not work, does not bring solutions in a situation when there is no unity, when you have political leaders coming to Brussels or wherever the meeting takes place with purely national agendas. Then they oppose European solutions or proposals of European solutions to the problems. And then on their way home, they criticize Europe for inaction or for lack of action. I think this is something which makes me and probably many of us indeed worrying. What we also see that the actions in the European Council are in fact just taking place under pressure of current problems, that we suffer from the short-termism in thinking, that we also go back to what we used to call the lowest level, lowest common denominator for many decisions. The compromises are more and more difficult to be reached. And what is to my shock, I've heard from several think tanks now that the world, the notion of muddling through is back on the European agenda, because I remember it was 15, 10 years ago, we were talking during the 80s already, we were talking about muddling through, and now with all those inefficiencies in intergovernmental approach to decision making in Europe, we see this muddling through again. And my worry, my particularly strong worry, is that I don't see really trends toward more political cohesion in among the leadership, national leadership, in spite of the fact that very often those national leaders recognize the need of European solution. But in spite of this, I think we don't see this cohesion emerging. Surprisingly also, if you think of Eurozone, because Eurozone is an area where theoretically it should be much more easy to see common interest and to find agreement on common move forward. But instead we continue to see heated debates, which people of course do not understand why we have heated debates on issues which should be obvious today. And people also listening to this tend to turn their back towards European Union. So I think that this, in general, I would say that this also this notion of taking the responsibility or taking, how did you say it, Antonio, back political, taking the what they are doing here back, which the Brits started to use, and we just, so taking control back. It's Polish also, they are trying to take control back to national capitals. So at the same time, they see the need of European solution. They want to take the control back to national capitals. And then if you ask me, where are those capitals where you can find European solutions? I don't see many of them in Europe. So as a result, we are facing this growing conflict between the national identities, which are growing, the importance of national identity, and the need of European integration. And I think that this weakens definitely the Europe's capacity to find solution. So I guess that this challenge to have the national leaders understand how much depends on them, because they are the major intermediary between Europe and the citizens. No matter what we do, they will remain, governments will remain this intermediary, and they should be aware of the damage that is being done, because they also undermine the people's commitment to Europe, to European values, to solidarity. So it's not only that we don't see it on the government level, but we don't see it also, we see less and less of it at national level, because of the fact that pro-European thinking is something which we don't see at the level of national leadership, pro-European action, we don't see it. If you look at the implementation of commitments European made at European level by national governments, this is also very low. In 2015, Commission launched 40 infringement procedures in the context of the asylum law, the related to refugees or migration in general, but that's what is really taking place. And additionally, what we hear very often is that we have to take the control back home to national capitals, because that's where democracy is. And I have serious doubts about this. Having said that, I agree that we have done not enough to make Europe democratically accountable, and that even we in the European Parliament, which is the major institution that should provide this accountability or legitimacy, we are very slow on it. And I think people do not have yet European Parliament in the hearts or in the guts or wherever you keep the European Parliament. So here we have this problem that we continue in Europe with this traditional approach to democracy, which is national level democracy. And this is extremely difficult. So the next issue I would like to raise is the vision, because we normally, there are many comments on how unimportant and impossible and unnecessary visions are, because we have to be extremely pragmatic now. I disagree with this approach. If you, we, of course, in the European Union, we never wanted to discuss the finalité politique, and I can understand why. We were not really too often reaching out to sort of visions for certain policies or certain issues because majority change and you cannot make the commitment. So we usually go step by step, but with step by step very often allows us to reach a moment where a majority is gone and we are left with unfinished business because political will expires and that's why it's dangerous. But there are moments when you cannot, I think, find a solution without proposing a vision. I personally think as an ordinary citizen, I would like to know where my political leaders want to take me and I would like to know where Europe wants to go and I would like to really be enthusiastic or mobilized. I think I would have to know more about where we are going to and not just being informed that there is a new regulation adopted. So I think we can find a better balance now between the need of a vision and this need of being pragmatic and really delivering solutions, which we have always seen as extremely important. And I think that in the times of the lack of trust, I think vision is absolutely fundamental. That's why I hope that this kind of double track that we have, the Bratislava, which is pragmatic, the Bratislava roadmap, which is pragmatic, where you have all those things related to migration, terrorism, security, and economy there. So we have this, and I hope that Rome will be this second leg for this double track, will provide a vision. The third issue which I would like to raise, and this is with referencing to what President Giscard said about the what I call differentiated integration, where he made this sort of natural core of Europe, that's how I understand this, is Eurozone, which you don't have to look for. There is an objective reason to have a differentiated integration because there is the Eurozone. And I think we have to take it really seriously. It is the fact of life. The difference between the depths of integration within the Eurozone and in the group which does not share the common currency, this will grow. And I think it's in the interest of all of us, those in and those out, that Eurozone is stable and that Eurozone proceeds with all the reforms. We, of course, will have to make the European Commission responsible for seeing that this differentiated integration does not generate discrimination for those who are not in, or that there is also there are special clauses that single market cannot suffer from this. So I think this is something which we just have to take as a something given. And it is, I think, responsibility of the political leaders in the countries that do not want for the time being to share the common currency. It's their responsibility that maybe those people will not benefit as strongly from the integration as those who are in the Eurozone might benefit. On the treaty change, because that was also, you wanted me to react, so I think treaty change is something that we should discuss it seriously, because we hear really that when anybody starts to talk about the treaty change, then all the politicians say, no, forget about it. It's something which is, people do not want a treaty change. You cannot get the majority for the treaty change. And I think here we have two tasks. One is we should just take this issue away from this image of a kind of taboo. Treaty change should be increasingly, I think, presented by everybody to ordinary citizens as a normal instrument of our work, because the world is changing, we are changing, Europe is changing, people, today's society is completely different from how we were organized and how we functioned 10 or 15 years ago, and we are, the design of the treaty, in fact, is already, I think, like 1,000 years ago, because we now have to root much better the European democracy in civil society, in make it just more inclusive and participatory. And we just, the treaty is designed in such a way that it's extremely traditional and does not allow us to get people on board and to make Europe really involving citizens in decision making and to have also a better solution for the structural dialogue or policy dialogue between national and European parliaments. So I think we should try to convince the people, the public, but not we in Brussels, but at national, local level, the treaty change or a new treaty is something that we might really need. Because, Antonio, just let's be clear, we have been stretching the current treaties to the impossible. If you listen to Karlsruhe, I mean, we probably, or if you listen to ECB, I think they have, there is so much doubt about the legal basis for a lot of things which we are doing. So I think that also looking at it from this point of view, I think we should just change our approach. Nobody actually mentioned young people here, and I thought that that this is something which I'm not going to elaborate a lot on it, but we had yesterday a meeting with young people in the AFCO committee, during the AFCO committee, and I think what we have to change also is just this approach. We are making them lazy, we are making them really too patient for everything, because we are all the time thinking what we can do for them. We propose all those solutions to help young people with employment and with education, but I think we should rather push them to start feeling responsible for Europe, for the Europe of the future, because we are talking only about what Europe can do for the young people, and it's right, we should do a lot to make their life brighter in the future and make them well prepared to the competition globally. But I think we don't do enough to make them involved in such a way that they would start feeling that they are also responsible for Europe. If you look at what happens with first-time voters in my part of Europe, it's just amazing. First-time voters vote nearly exclusively for radical parties and all those the most strange, like for fun nearly. This is something which we have also to address. And now that they are just linking with the global world just with one click, they might stop needing Europe. Then they don't need politics at all, because it's not needed to get what they need to get from the external world. And on democratic deficit, which was also mentioned, I think, by Klaus, I think that we are, because we have had many periods in European history, integration, history of integration, where we are talking about the democratic deficit, sometimes more, sometimes less. But I think this time around, it's much more than democratic deficit. If I take seriously what you are saying about populists and all those things, what is in fact endangered is European values, actually, because they take people so far away from what we care for and what is not necessarily shared by the entire world, that I think that the values are in danger. And I think it's not to say too much if I say that if we without values, we are just lost, I think, because that's really the basic things that normally keeps us together. And then on the people are fed up with institutions, because that was also quite strong. I think Klaus was saying it quite strongly. But then, I don't know if you know this saying, that when a man and a woman meet, they can create something grand, but to make it last, you need institutions. So without institutions, I think we will not be able to continue the integration. And we are undermining the institutions. We see it in the now what leaders say, political, national, about the European Commission. European Parliament has always been presented as something that nobody knows what it is for. So we just have to fight all the time to show that institutions are extremely important. And I think it is not too much to expect from people today that they understand the importance of institutions, as they understand the importance of ministries at home, of national parliaments, of in some countries constitutional tribunals are also seen as important. And so it's a... I think I wouldn't sort of shy away with the discussion on institutions, but I think we don't need to discuss institutions. Institutions will be all the time improved, just being upgraded and adjusted to the challenges. So we are using, I think, this discussion on institutions in a political context, which is damaging, I think, the institutions. So I guess I would stop on this. And I didn't. I managed not to mention Brexit, which I find extremely successful on my side.
Dziękuję bardzo, pani profesorze. Thank you so much indeed, panie profesor Hübner. Now, I would like to invite all speakers, the four of them, including Mr. Peterle, obviously, and the audience, to react to what is on the table. There is obviously many convergent approaches, and at the same time, different considerations, we could say. I mean, some are in favor, or indeed proceed for some changes and eventually some other treaties. At the same time, Mr. Vitorino said that everything is in the Lisbon Treaty, and probably meaning that lots of provisions of the Lisbon Treaty have not yet been completely developed.
Just want to talk to girl always.
So, Mr. Vitorino, would you like to react, or anybody would like to have a question or introduce into the debate? Not for the time being. Okay. Please. Sorry.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman. My name is Amajit Bamra. I'm here from England. With all that the wonderful speakers have, their views that they've shared with us this evening, part of the problem in the United Kingdom during the referendum process was immigration. I just really need to cast your attention to that particular factor, and especially the sort of unstoppable immigration coming into Europe from, you know, the Mediterranean rim and Syria and etc. So does the European Union actually have a policy on that?
Mr. Hensch, vous voudriez réagir in French or in English?
I think the European Union has not a coherent policy of that, on for that. It has a reaction, a common reaction, which is to increase border controls and to close some borders on the Balkan route. This has been accepted by member states. But on the consequences, on the total consequences on the demographic problems we will have in Europe, and with people coming to Europe, there is no relevant European, common European answer in the moment. The standards, for example, for asylum are different between member states. This makes some member states more attractive than others to people who come to Europe. That is one point. Another point is we have different positions on the question of immigration, which is different to asyl. So I can't see a real common European immigration policy at the moment. But all people who whom I know are telling me that it is necessary.
Mr. Vitorino, would you like to add a comment to that?
I mean, I share Klaus' view in the sense that I think that defining a comprehensive asylum and migration policy has been downplayed in the last year at the EU level, partially because the pressure was not there, and as Danute said, more often, politicians don't only take decisions under pressure, partly also because you need to tackle the so-called mixed flows, people coming to Europe, that in the same waves meet together genuine refugees, asylum seekers, and economic migrants. So you cannot just address these kind of flows having a biased view on one part of it. You need to have a comprehensive approach to all of them. Having said that, I do not want to dispute your interpretation about UK referendum, but the question was not only about third country nationals who came to the European Union. The question in the British debate was that immigration meant also other EU citizens who would go to the UK. And the addressing one issue and the other are two different things. First and foremost, they are two different things. And one thing is a fundamental right of EU citizens. It is the right to free movement. Another thing is economic migration from third countries, which is a different, totally different framework. I share Klaus' view that at the current moment there is no, in my view, mutual trust of the among the EU member states to have a common approach to migration and asylum. So I would favour to use the Lisbon Treaty and use the mechanism of enhanced cooperation to have a group of countries that would dare to have such a common approach combined, refugee and migration at the same time, and find in complement a mechanism of compensation with the others that would stay outside, a financial compensation of the financial burden that these policies always will represent.
Thank you, Mrs. Hübner. Oh, Mr. Peterle, please.
First of all, I would like to say that we never were facing such type of migration in the history, but this migration has shown the consequences of the absence of the European policy. And European response was needed. If, in case that external borders are not safe, then of course internal borders get relevance, and this is what happened. So this is just one example which speaks for common European policy, but not just in this regard. Thank you.
Professor,
I think it's an extremely important issue because the reaction of Antonio was also that he has slightly different also understanding of how the migration issue has been seen by the UK citizens, and what was also the narrative of the politicians of Mr. Cameron, who never addressed the issue of migration from third countries, but he was talking about the Romanians or Poles coming to the UK to work. And so I think this dimension is extremely important. Because we have today, more or less in UK, 3.5 million of people of Europeans from the other 27 member states. At the same time, we have a little bit more, probably, than 2 million of the British citizens residing in, for example, in Spain, you have probably 1 million of those residing in other 27 member states. So whatever will be the solution, it will affect both sides of this account. And also what I think is extremely important to understand that when we talk in general migration, that correct me, Antonio, if I'm wrong, but I think till Lisbon Treaty, the migration was basically the competence, with some exceptions, the competence of member states, and the Commission could start to intervene more seriously only now over the last years. But I don't want to explain that why we don't have a good policy, but because now we see it today as a joint action between the Commission and member states, but for years we didn't have this capacity, this competence as European Union. And the last thing which I would like to raise is that you might remember that in February Mr. Cameron got a deal with the European Union. Once the referendum is to stay, the result, then this deal would enter into effect. Now it's dead, of course. But in this deal, there was a mechanism that UK would be able to trigger in the case of the invasion of too many of European citizens going to UK. And actually, already in February, the situation was, it is in the deal that this mechanism could be triggered already immediately after the referendum because the conditions were met. And this was never presented to the British public, as I think, in such a way that it would reach the public. In any case, it didn't have any impact, I understand, on the vote, because still the decision was to leave. So there is a lot of myths around this issue and misunderstanding as well. And we can imagine that those 2 million of UK, if we have to leave UK after the sort of hard Brexit, then those 2 million would also go back to UK, and especially from Spain, mostly pensioners using a very generous health system in Spain, would also ask for the health service, the UK health system, and that would be, I think, extremely costly in spite of the fact that the way it was presented during the election, which was a false way of presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. I believe the gentleman on the second row would like to intervene or mix up in the debate, please.
Thank you. I'm Veselinovic from Slovenia, and first of all, I would like to congratulate Mr. Peterle on organizing this necessary event, so to say, and very interesting one. We all know that there are some necessary changes to European Union, but as a true European, I, of course, believe in that very strongly. However, I have also impression, on the other hand, that if we push for these necessary changes in European Union, that some other countries might have some problems, you know, getting through them, you know. So it is kind of trade-off at the moment. Maybe another country could become problematic regarding leaving European Union if pushing for some changes. So actually we have a serious problem what to do now. So we know the changes have to be made on one hand. On the other hand, how to do them. So obviously, as some of you discussed, changes of treaty are necessary. And I think we should go for them. But what would happen, let's say, if these changes would not be accepted by, let's say, most of the country or even all of them? So this is a serious problem, I think. And for the time being, I don't see any national leader in the European Union who's able to push some necessary European Union changes in his own country. I don't see that. And I think Mr. Vitorino, or who mentioned that we should wait maybe for some elections now in some important bigger countries and let's see what happens then. And of course, not knowing what can happen there in these countries, we don't know what exactly will be the proportion of those pro-European or contra-European, you know. And look how politics changed recently. I mean, we had two, I would say, surprisingly results lately in the global world. Brexit was one, and just yesterday the elections in U.S., both, actually, the polls didn't predict that. The polls were much in favor of different results. So obviously, I mean, people want some changes. They don't want to express them through the polls. But when they go really, you know, to vote, they would vote for some, you know, major changes. So I think we have really a problem regarding these issues. And just a brief comment. Not so long ago, I participated in monetaristic kind of a round table, and I was advocating some necessary changes, including what President Giscard d'Estaing mentioned, tax unification in Europe. I think it's necessary for normal economic union, of course. And of course, some other necessary changes regarding especially financial sector, but also, you know, in economy. In this roundtable participated people from Britain, France, Italy, and Austria, and from Slovenia, of course. And I was highly criticized by all of them. You know, all were saying, no, we don't want more Europe. We want some our national rights. We don't want someone from Brussels to dictate us even more than now, and so on. So, and that, of course, came into media and so on, you know. So, I mean, we have these questions and problems. So we need changes. We know what to do, basically, more or less. Of course, we can discuss if one-third of, let's say, national representatives in the European Parliament would be enough, or two-thirds, like President discussed, or Mr. Bratton, who was very clear about his thoughts. This is maybe a matter of discussion, but something has to be done. But the question is how. Thank you.
So we're talking as well as any kind of timetable. By the way, just very shortly, we were talking about the elections agenda. We have probably, it's interesting maybe, to have in mind what happened in Spain, what happened in Greece, what happened in Portugal in another way, and what will eventually happen in Italy on the 4th of December with the referendum Matteo Renzi has launched. Mr. Hensch would like to...
Yes, some words on we need the change, or we need a change, as you said. Let's be honest and clear about that. The crucial question is changes in what direction? There are a lot of attempts in member states to push for more Europe, more competences, financial, on taxes, and so on and so on. And there are also a lot of people pushing for less Europe. That is to say, to reduce, and that is also a change, to reduce the union. Yes, me too. But I know not by a referendum, not by opinion polls, also I know what people think at the moment. And let me say, not in all member states, but in my own, in Germany, and also in the Netherlands, and in Denmark, and some others. And I know that there would be possibly a majority if we would propose them to support a reduction of the importance of the European integration. They are only in favor of having an internal market without any ecological policy, without any social policy, and so on and so on. And if we, in the moment we are, in the historic moment we are in the moment, if we plead for change, then I fear that the change would go backwards. And that's why I'm, in my opinion, it is necessary to hold on in that situation as we are. Because if we open the box, then we will see that the result will be quite another, as we and you hope.
Thank you. Professor Hübner, please, and then we go for
Ed, that may change. That may change in 5 or 6 or 7 years or 10 years. It is not the end of history in this, on this continent. I am convinced it is not the end. But in the moment, we have to be better careful than too courageous.
Just for the sake of having a discussion also, I would like to say the following. So the option is, as we see today, is exactly this, to take control back to national capital. So maybe to go for a while towards intergovernmental way of handling Europe and reduce its role in what happens in our development and growth in all the changes which are crucial for also for our future. The problem is there is a risk that we will dismantle Europe, because then how you can stop this process if you try to prove to the people that democracy is at national level, solutions are at national level, so we don't need Europe. And there are some people who are seriously saying that it's true, maybe for a while we should go into this type of approach. But then what can be the trigger to go back, to start again, to restart the European negotiation? So I personally believe that we can make Europe really democratic, root it in the civil society also across Europe, only through more cooperation. And if we can really show that this cooperation brings results, because we know very well that, for example, on migration, we will not find a solution if we stick to national options. We just need European solutions. solution. That's why I think that we should really have guts and courage to show to the people that we need more cooperation now. And the last thing in this context, because the question is whether such a deep crisis and this lack of trust and this lack of happiness among people with Europe, which politicians claim exists, whether this is a legitimacy to for a big change, or is it a legitimacy to go to sleep for a while? I think this is a legitimacy for big change, and that's why I think it's I would rather say that we should find a solution through really more cooperation, more engagement, bringing people, showing them that we are delivering, that the solutions are in Europe. Because if you look, you provoked me. Because if you look exactly at what happened in the US, but also if you look at the referendum campaign in the UK, it was all based, I'm sorry to say this, on lies. It was all based on false promises. In the UK, they failed, so they don't have to prove anything now. But Mr. Trump will have to prove that he was not lying and he was not making false promises, I understand. And this might be extremely difficult because I think it's not real, implementable, this kind of policy. So. Yeah, I don't know. We should go back to truth, stop lying probably to people and take them seriously that it's worse. It's bad, but it can be worse unless we do more cooperation in Europe. That's my solution, my recipe.
Entering into fight. Mr. Peterle, please, and then we go for the gentleman.
So I think that we are speaking terms in many respects, and I prepared some conclusions, but I will share one of them with you now, because it's time to do that. I think it's not time to speak about more Europe, but the question is how to avoid much less Europe. I don't like to speak about better Europe. It's quite a foggy term, in my view, but what Madam Hübner said is the line I would like to follow. This is functioning Europe. People understand whether borders are safe or not, whether agreements are implemented or not, and the answer to the mistrust or lack of trust is the functioning Europe. And this means, of course, cooperation. And I think that we have to integrate people's concerns, citizens' concerns, into our new vision. And I'm sure that we can integrate those concerns in a non-populistic way. I think this is the solution. And once people will see again functioning Europe, the mistrust will get to disappear. And I also think that our first problem is not Brexit, is not to change the treaties, but to use, John Bruton said, look about ourselves. I would say we have to deal with ourselves, first of all, not with all possible challenges around us. And the sooner we will find answer based on new vision, the better for us. What I wish is that we avoid, I use a radical term, a destructive phase in the European development, to come back after 10 or 20 years, how...
Close the shop for a while.
Yeah, how Europe was needed. So I would like to avoid that. And here I see a major duty of this House, which has the strongest democratic legitimacy among common European institutions, to use this, I would say, responsibility and to participate with great attention and responsibility the debate of future of Europe. In fact, this was one of the reasons why I undertook this initiative. One more point. You know, this existing legal framework gives us huge opportunities to express political will if there is. No? And I remember Yugoslavia, how it ended. You know, when something went wrong in Yugoslavia, they always changed the legislation. But it didn't happen, you know. It had to be, the behavior had to be changed, you know. And I see some parallels with the situation in the European Union now. And I was pleased that Valéry Giscard-Destain explained with so clear words his idea. And even for that, as he said, we don't need new treaty. If those who wish to do more together, they are allowed to, because they have enough provisions in the Lisbon Treaty. And maybe this is the way forward, that those who wish enhanced cooperation, that they do that. And my last point in that regard, European Parliament, national parliaments, even for that we don't need any changes of treaties, but we need a more ambitious model of cooperation between European Parliament and national parliaments. It is possible, I'm sure.
Thank you. The gentleman.
Andreas Strignitz, I'm civil servant in the House. I would like to address two issues. The first is security and defense. It has been mentioned already. And I think when we look at the Eurobarometers, the recent Eurobarometers, then it becomes very clear that for European citizens, security is the most important issue, and that the majority of Europeans want more cooperation in security and defense. And by the way, it's one area I know, but this is really the area where we have not used the full potential of the treaty, thinking about PESCO, Permanent Structured Cooperation, and many other issues. So there are a lot of things we can do, and it's in line what the majority of Europeans want. And here comes also the issue of Brexit. It's true that we lose military capacities with a Brexit, but on the other hand, many issues might become easier, because the UK was very often a blocking stone in this area. And the second aspect is that with the election outcome in the US, I think there is a need for stronger cooperation, because we don't know what will come, but looking into statements from Trump on NATO, we are obliged to look for a stronger European pillar within NATO, and for CSDP, of course. So I would like to commend to listen to your comments on that. My second point is more general, and this is, I think, comes to the core of the problem. The election outcome also in the US shows the growing problem of populism. And this is not only a US phenomenon, it's a phenomenon also in Europe. And here it comes to the key problem, which, because it questions the whole European project. And this is something new. We always had crises in European history, but the project as such has never been questioned. And Giscard d'Estaing has mentioned that. If we don't tackle this issue, that people start to question what we are doing here, then the next elections might become a disaster. And that we need to find answer to this problem. Some say we live in a post-factual time, because factuals don't count. We all know, I think we would agree, that Europe is not responsible for globalization and for creating globalization losers. But it is seen by many in Europe that Europe has not prevented, has not done enough to prevent of the negative impact of globalization. And here, I think here we need really to think, and maybe you can elaborate a bit on that. Thank you.
Mr. Vitorino, you were Minister of Defense of Portugal, and you're quite sensitive to that, and indeed Klaus Hensch has made some references to NATO, and we are witnessing in the past weeks and months that NATO is maneuvering quite a lot in Poland, Lithuania, Baltic states, Romania. How would you react to that? Because indeed, this is among the strongest challenges we are facing now.
Well, I try to address the issue saying that I believe that in our relationship with the UK, NATO will go on being a key factor of cooperation. And from the operational point of view, NATO is a rather efficient organization, largely depending on American assets. If there is a sudden change in behavior from the American, the new American administration, probably in a debate like this one in a few years' time, we will not exactly saying the same thing that we are saying today. If there is less commitment of the US in NATO, definitely NATO will be less effective than it is today. This is a lapalis truth, but it's important to underline, because if at the same time it is an opportunity for the Europeans to take more seriously an agenda on security and defense, I agree. At the same time, you need to realize that we are jumping on that area, losing one of our key assets, the British. Because it is true that the British were reluctant, extremely reluctant, sometimes even. But it is also true that one of the two countries that can project forces is the UK. That the UK has a worldwide vision that includes the use of military forces, which is not exactly the typical approach of Europeans when it comes to having a profile in international relations. And Klaus Hensch has emphasized one key point. We should not be overambitious in the short term, because if we do not have the capabilities and the capacities, we create the illusion that we can deliver what we cannot deliver. So it needs to be a step-by-step approach. And by the way, it costs money. It should be bear in mind that there is no free rides in defense and security. So I would say that the window of opportunity is there. The tools that the Treaty of Lisbon provide us are there. The political will is not yet there, but if the politicians want to be in line with the concerns of the citizens, it should be there one day, because definitely, as you mentioned, this is a policy area where the citizens are much more aware of the need of international cooperation, European cooperation, than anyone else, than any other area. The point is that it needs to be well planned and financed. And that is a task that comes upon the shoulders, not only of the European institutions, but also of the member states. Nevertheless, one single point. I now, for some time, I will never mention opinion polls, because with the disappointment of tonight, I will take some months before I recover any kind of trust in opinion polls.
Mr. Hensch, would you like to?
Just in addition, because I share Vitorino's point, you are right. Most of the people want more cooperation, unique, if it is possible or would be possible, unique European defense. They are in favor. But if you look a little bit closer to the point, then you will see, and we use the treaty already, not sufficiently, but nevertheless, there is a certain use. If you look at armaments cooperation, okay, we should do better than we do, but we have started. If you look at organization, headquarters, and so on, there were some problems with Turkey. Maybe they are solved now. I hope so, because they tried to blackmail the Union by opposing a European headquarter. Okay. We try to come to Eurocorps and so on. But if you ask, at least I speak as a German, if you ask to have a European army, you will see in the opinion polls there would perhaps not a majority, but a considerable percentage in favor. But if you then tell them that in most member states it is not a parliamentary army, but it is an army as an instrument for the government, And if you tell that a European army would have the same would be the same in a certain way as the French and the British and so on, and that it is no longer possible that the German Bundestag decides where and when German soldiers will be active in other theatres, then you will see the opposite what they have said before. Then they will absolutely be against. So you understand where the problem is. That is also in a lower way and to a lower point, also the same problem with foreign policy. All people say, yes, Europe must speak with one voice in the world. But if it comes to the point, yeah, what would you say with one voice? Then you will have immediately split the whole thing up. Let me say one point only to the question, globalization. Yes, you are right. I agree. We all agree. The Union does not protect sufficiently people from the consequences of globalization. Okay. They have even the impression that Europe is fueling globalization. Not protecting, but fueling. But we have to be clear about that it is not Europe where the debate is on. It is an inner society debate in all our member states. And let me not name it globalization. It is an inner society debate on more liberalism or more protectionism, to put it in simple terms. And the Union has a genetic problem. It has been created as a market, a free market economy, not only inside, but also outside. And to furnish or to create that protection which a lot of people in our member states want, the Union should deliver, then it is against the genetic program of our whole Union. That is our problem. It is a political problem. It isn't a problem of the European institutions and so on. It is the problem in our own national societies.
Then, yeah, Professor Hübner here, please.
On this globalization-related issue, you might remember, Klaus, no, you were not around here when we established this Global Adjustment Fund. And we make the decisions nearly every plenary session. There is a list of this support coming from the Global Adjustment Fund to different enterprises or different communities where the globalization has led to the closure of factory and produced unemployment. And we do a lot of it, but who knows about that? I've never seen in a public space any information or any sort of expression of description of this action of the European Union. And secondly, when we have the problems with CETA or with TTIP, we in fact never managed to get through to the public that the very fact that we negotiate the free trade agreements on behalf of 28 member states puts us in a much stronger position, and because of that Europe is in fact defending also individual member states and individual citizens from the impact of globalization, because we are more efficient in those negotiations. But also on the security, I share very much this profound analysis that Klaus Hansch presented. I would just like to add one or two or three comments, because we are now moving in this direction, of course, and I think we have the strategy. We have also the declaration with NATO, which was signed in, which is quite, I think, new and positive development, signed in Warsaw. And we have also in December, I think, summit on security. So we are clearly moving in this direction. we might not need, because we are criticized sometimes because of the headquarters that we would like to see, but we do not have access to the chain of command of NATO. So we are basically helpless if we don't have our own mechanism of planning or contingency planning or organizing these things. So, but I hope that we will move it. And I would like just to add on Brexit in this context, that if you look really at how UK over the last 6-7 years, how they were gradually, I don't want to say withdrawing, but declining, reducing their involvement in military missions. Now they are on the, I think, fifth after Spain, even in terms of the size of contribution to the military operations. And if you look at the civil missions, they are even behind Poland on 6th or 7th position. So they have been already for a while being less involved in this context in European defense capacity and the operations. Thank you.
Thank you. I believe Mr. Vitorino has to leave slightly earlier. So to address the very extremely sensitive point that you raised about populism and current trends in the different, in the United States and in the different member states of the European Union. Mr. Vitorino, how do you feel the reactions? First, where are those populist political forces are capitalizing? How are they managing, capitalizing on what and why? It's a long analysis maybe, but I mean, why is it, and directions are differing from one country to another one?
Well, it's a long story, and I think Alojz will have to organize a new colloquium on that on that subject. I think that we have not been able to persuade our fellow citizens that the European Union is the sole instrument that the member states have to regulate globalization. And on the contrary, the perception that the citizens have is that the European Union is the Trojan horse of globalization that they associate with evil. And Klaus is absolutely right. We have built the internal market overcoming barriers, trade barriers, tariff barriers, customs duties, and so on. So our genetic aim is to open up the borders. And that includes also international trade. At the current moment, there is a trend in our societies against free trade because they consider it associated with unfair trade. And we have never been able to make the case that the existing platform of called European Union is the only tool that individual member states have to limit the unfair aspects of trade and to create some form of regulation at global level. But that is not new. I mean, it was very evident in CETA, it was very evident in TTIP, but we cannot ignore that to a certain extent, for instance in Germany, the trend in the public opinion is very negative in relation to the negotiation of TTIP with the United States. We are not surprised with the fact that the French public opinion might be against, that's quite traditional, but we might be very much surprised with the trend in Germany. And we cannot ignore those people. We cannot ignore those people. So we need to make the case and make a demonstration, not just in words, that our negotiating position is in favor of free trade, but that we safeguard in those agreements the concerns and the anxieties of our fellow citizens. And to a certain extent, as Pascal Lamy usually says, our traditional statement on free trade was about protecting less or more producers. And this new generation of free trade agreements, it's not as much as protecting producers. It's very much on protecting consumers. And consumers are all the citizens. So the scope is a different one, and we did not make the shift in our narrative to be able to demonstrate the added value of having the Union at the helm of the negotiation. But this is a long story, I'm afraid.
Professor Hübner, on the populism and the different reactions. Now, well, the...
Everything, I mean, it's a seminar, that's true. But I think in very short, I guess that populists built on fear, and in this context, security, it's not only military security, even though in Europe, because of Russia and Ukraine, you can also think in this terms, but it's also economic security. But I think this time also populism... I see you 29, right? Yeah, okay. But this time it's not only fear, I think. This time it's also about the feeling of unfairness because and inequality. So it's a big debate, another debate. But I think people indeed fear that they are not participating and those inequalities that grow, and we have it everywhere in the media, the famous 1%. So people feel, and I know it from Poland, those who didn't benefit from transition, didn't feel they benefit from membership in the European Union. So there is this feeling of unfairness, which is very easy to be used by populists. And it's extremely difficult without changing the reality. It's very difficult to reverse this trend. But I also think that in the context of the TTIP, and we continue to make mistakes, the good European politicians who were saying over the last months to get CETA adopted, they're saying, no, TTIP is horrible, we have to restart the negotiations, but CETA is good, so please go for CETA. And people already heard so much now from the politicians of the mainstream that TTIP is bad and we have to start again, then it will be now without any exit strategy. So now we will have to, how to turn it back and how to convince people that we were saying that TTIP is bad, but now we are going to say that TTIP is good. So I think we make also this type of mistakes in what we are doing. But I would just like to go back to what you were saying about the also the difference now and before in terms of criticism of European Union, that now it's serious because now the project is questioned, not deficiencies of project, but the project as such. And I was ineptly probably trying to say that this time the problem is not democratic deficit, but the problem is that European values are questioned. And that's exactly what you said in a different way, that we have really to see that the threat to Europe, the risk of dismantling Europe, and if we do it, then it's just dismantling into 28 irrelevant states, because we know very well globally, each of us individually is not strong enough. So it is serious, but we always have to remember how much we achieved.
Thank you so much indeed. We still have one question, and then we will go for the conclusions with Mr. Alojz Peterle.
Thanks for the floor. I'm Peter Magyar from Hungary. Having heard a strong statement about the president-elect of the United States and the lies, please allow me to have another strong question and being a bit populist. Do you think really that you can gain back the trust of the EU citizens with any treaty change or institutional reforms? Don't you think that maybe to be being a bit, again, populist, better sometimes listening to the citizens? As a populist, I can imagine that it could be annoying for the ordinary citizens and for the younger generation also, hearing the president of the Commission speaking with beautiful words about tax evasion in the State of the Union speech. The president of the Commission, who was the prime minister of Luxembourg for 18 years. I can imagine that it could be annoying to knowing that that the ex-president of the Commission just got a nice job from the Goldman Sachs after the financial crisis, which was caused by financial institution, for example, the Goldman Sachs. And I can imagine that it could be annoying for ordinary citizens having heard that that the ex-commissioner get 8,000 euros per month, and these ex-commissioners are now prime ministers, acting prime ministers, acting MEPs, members of the European Parliament. I can imagine it could be sometimes annoying, and I am not sure that you will solve any problem or you can gain back the trust of the citizens. So just a concrete question to Madame Hübner. You are discussing now in the AFCO committee the electoral law reform. And the aim of this reform to, as far as I know from the Council, to increase the turnout, maybe, the European Parliament elections. Are you really sure that with the logo or with compulsory threshold, you will gain, you will increase the turnout, you will gain back the trust of the younger generations? Because we know that the turnout is really low among the younger citizens. Thank you.
Well, Professor Hübner, you were addressed directly, and then we might have a complimentary answer.
You know, because what I don't like in the way you approach the whole issue, because I think the challenge is tremendous, and we share the I think your concerns, most of us probably. But you are sort of picking up, and you think that anybody here has said that with the treaty change or with the institutional change, you can get citizens on board or you can address the democratic deficit. Nobody's saying this. I'm saying actually the opposite. I think that we should demystify the issue of treaty changes. They should happen when we need this, and this is not, nobody is doing it against citizens. We have to be able to prove it, to show it, and to get people also to support it, and we are very bad in communicating. We know it very well, but nobody is saying that this is something that could be the solution. The same institutional institutions should adjust all the time. We should probably create a minister or treasury, what President Girardes mentioned. But we make out of it the big issue, and we put on the people, and they say people don't care about institutions. They shouldn't care. Why should they care about the institution? We should care, and we should be responsible, and we should be then voted in the European elections or national elections, just being criticized for what we did or we didn't do. So I don't think that this is a recipe, the treaty change or institutional change for getting people on board. I think, for example, what I was trying to say, that I think our treaty, we of course put the citizens, there is national parliament issue as well, there is a lot more than in the previous treaties, but the general philosophy of the treaty is that it is not really deeply rooted in the democracy and in democracy at the European level. It is not really rooted in the civil society. We don't have mechanisms there that would ensure that the whole process of legislation is taking on board the views somehow expressed. We have to organize this by people. So I think we have outdated institutions. If you think that, well, the basic thing was created, that was back in 1950s, and in the meantime, or even if you look at the last treaty only, in the meantime, we have dramatic change of how this society functions, what are the interests of the society. What I still think is extremely important is that we really try to, because you will not get people, young people involved if they don't feel responsible for something. That's my feeling. I was getting involved because I felt I can contribute, I felt I am responsible. If we create this image that we, the aged cohorts of politicians, that we can do something that would look attractive for the young people, I don't believe in it. So that's why we need young people involved in the whole process. And my perception of young people is that they are not interested in politics. They don't need it to live, to get the, to make the click and to get the information. So the challenge is much bigger, and I think, but it doesn't come through us doing something to get attention of young people, to make something they will be happy. They should just get involved and take the things in their own hands. That's, I think, how my generation did it. So that's what I am. And on electoral law, there's a lot more there. And it is, I hope, because, you know, I don't know if you read the first version. Maybe you are now, you know how the member states have just got rid of everything, including electronic vote, and what we believed would be, because we have examples where young people got more involved through the internet voting and many other things. So it is, I'm sorry. It is there is a problem, but we are really open to talk and get you involved and listen to your proposals.
Thank you so much indeed. And now I would like to invite Mr. Alojz Peterle to draw or to propose and draw some conclusions, provisional ones probably, because the debate will go on for weeks, months and years anyway. And given the fact that we have an agenda before the European elections in 2019. Please.
Thank you, Michel. Before conclusions, I would like to use my memory. 25 years ago, before we introduced our own currency in Slovenia. This was in the year 91, before October 91, when I traveled from Ljubljana to Brussels, I had to change the then Yugoslav currency, which was called dinar, three times, first into shillings, then into marks, and then into Belgian franc. At each border, the value of Yugoslav dinar was lower because we had 23% inflation rate monthly. Western brains are not able, don't have matrix to understand that it was, no, not yearly, but monthly. So I saw divided Europe with the borders, and I don't like to see it anymore. And I'm in favor of the dialogue. We can compare and study different visions, but let be more consequence that our British colleagues were when they decided for Brexit, without counting or elaborating the consequences. I don't like that we develop a vision, and I would say that we jump into a pool without water. I'm very serious when I read or I hear the ideas of renationalization. No, but I would say, okay, let discuss it, but be aware of the consequences. And what Madam Hübner said about the lack of European values, I think it's a very serious position, as it was the warning of the Valéry Giscard d'Estaing, who said, use the time before new European elections, if you don't like to be surprised too much. No? And I think that this is our duty. We must be ready for new surprises. We have to deepen our debate on future of Europe, and we have to develop long-term vision and respect and integrate people's concerns. And I think that the working together, I think that we were different in many respects, but not in this one, that working together can lead to better trust, to more trust into the European way. I think that time is running. And again, I don't like to have this disruptive or destructive phase in the European political developments. So we need Europe. We have to decide what does it mean to work together. Work together is the way. So I don't like to elaborate all very interesting ideas. I'm pleased and I'm thankful to the panelists that they found the time to share their views, concepts, ideas with us. I'm thankful to Michel Plumley for his excellent moderation of this debate, and I would like to express also my thanks to my collaborators who did a great work in organizing this not very simple debate today. So thank you all of us for coming, and do count on us in that regard because we have to continue with this debate. Thank you very much. Dankeschön, obrigat. Now Antonio left already. Thank you.
And dziękuję bardzo in po polsku. Thank you so much, and thank you to the interpreter as well.